Welcome to Dear SQL DBA, a podcast and YouTube show for SQL Server developers and database administrators. I'm Kendra Little from SQLWorkbooks.com. This week's episode is about PowerShell, and this episode is inspired both by a reader's question and by TSQL Tuesday. It's TSQL Tuesday for September 2017, and the host this month is Rob Sewell. Rob has challenged people to think about, talk about, and to code a little bit with PowerShell this month. And I also recently got a question from a reader who asked, as a database administrator, do I need to master PowerShell? How important is it for me to become an expert on PowerShell? And this is something that a lot of people wonder. How great do I need to be at scripting as a database administrator? Well, the amount of PowerShell that you need to know varies, but I do think that these days, PowerShell really is a little bit of a default just when it comes to basic things like managing files and directories in Windows. And even junior DBAs need to be comfortable with different methods of managing files and folders because of things like making copies of backups and moving backup files around, managing directories and permissions. And PowerShell is a great tool. When I first started as a DBA, we just had, you know, ye old command prompt, and we did DOS scripting for a lot of things. And I think the default now is really to use PowerShell. But getting comfortable with those basics isn't super hard. You know, you've got to be comfortable looking at simple PowerShell scripts as a junior DBA. As you advance in your career, you do want to build some more skills there, but a lot of it, even as a senior DBA, you don't really need to master PowerShell in as much as you just need to be comfortable searching for scripts, reviewing them, adapting and testing them out safely, and then fitting them to your own purposes. So you don't have to write a bunch of code from scratch necessarily. You don't have to be necessarily super fluent. You can instead be pretty good at finding good sources and kind of cobbling together code. And there's lots of folks out there and communities out there now who you can ask, you know, do you have a snippet of code that I could use to do something? Could you review my PowerShell script for this and let me know if there's a better way to do this? There's the SQL Server Slack community. There's lots of PowerShell fans in there. There's PowerShell folks on Twitter that you can ask for tips on things. So you don't have to be great at PowerShell yourself. If you do really like PowerShell, you know, if you start playing with it and you find that you love scripting in it and you want to do a lot of it, you can find DBA jobs where you can write a lot of PowerShell and use it to automate installations, set up very large environments, do really cool things in the cloud, do really cool migrations. So if you're into PowerShell and you find you have a talent for it, you really want to master it, then by all means, that can fit really well into a career of working with data. It just isn't necessarily required. There are a lot of jobs that don't require writing PowerShell all the time and expanding your knowledge. But dabbling in it is super helpful for many of us. You know, I have been messing with PowerShell for a while. Back when I was a DBA, I loved automating SQL Server installations. It was fairly early days for PowerShell then, but I did use it as part of the setup scripts for our environment. And we had enough SQL servers that installing and configuring Windows and installing and configuring SQL Server, sometimes in clusters, sometimes not, it was something we did fairly commonly. So scripting as much as I could and using PowerShell in there, it was really fun and it was really handy. And these days you can do more and more with PowerShell. Instead, I had to call out to a lot of more old-fashioned tools to do things like configure the local security policy. And I imagine, I haven't looked at this lately, that there's better ways to do that in PowerShell these days. It's been quite a few years since I did that project. But these days, I still use PowerShell. I have been using it recently to generate test load against SQL Server. So I wrote a session on finding top queries in SQL Server. And to do a demo of finding top queries, you need to generate some activity with queries, right? Well, one of the cool things about using PowerShell for this, you might just wonder, well, why don't you just have, you know, a script you run in Management Studio that generates the activity? Well, you can do that. But with PowerShell, it acts more like an application. And Management Studio is an application, I get that. But for example, with PowerShell, when you're calling a stored procedure in SQL Server, you can say, hey, I'm calling a stored procedure, and be really clear about the fact that you're not executing ad hoc SQL. That actually shows up differently in the performance counters in the SQL Server, because the SQL Server sees the command and knows immediately, hey, this is a stored procedure, I'm gonna go match it, instead of saying, oh, this is query text, oh, I see in the query text it's a stored procedure, I'm gonna go run it. You can also easily measure duration in the PowerShell. It's really easy to do things like set up reusable code and functions to say, okay, we're gonna loop through and run this a certain amount of times. There are some things though that I struggle with PowerShell. So it's really easy to do things like, PowerShell has this thing start job where you can say, okay, I wanna actually start a few jobs. And this sounds like a great way to be able to run activity on, you know, multiple threads at once against your SQL Server, and it works. But the thing I've struggled with is it's not that easy to control and make all the jobs start at the same time. You know, for lots of demo purposes, you know, I want multiple threads running something at the same time to be able to generate activity in some patterns. And what I'd find with the start job is some of my jobs start and then some of the other jobs start a little later, which when it comes to things like automation is probably what you want. You probably don't necessarily want all these jobs hammering your laptop or wherever you're running the jobs from at the same time. But for my purposes, it wasn't that perfect and it wasn't that easy to control. That being said, essentially, for certain things, if I want to run a burst of queries on multiple threads exactly at the same time, I might use another tool for that. So there's a tool called SQL Query Stress, which was originally written by Adam Mechanic. If you search for it, I think someone else has taken over. I think Adam open sourced it and someone else has taken control of the code. But for, you know, testing and generating demos, there's other options too. But PowerShell's really flexible and I love having multiple tools out there. I also kind of suspect that maybe someday someone will listen to this episode and be like, oh, Kendra, I've got a great way that you can, you know, make running those jobs easier or a different way to do it. Because the cool thing about PowerShell is it's really flexible and a lot of people love using it. So it's always evolving. There's new cool stuff to do. And whether you are just getting comfortable with it, whether you're at the level where you're finding and testing scripts from other people, or if you are that person who loves to write scripts, I encourage you to share your scripts online and to join the SQL Server community, whether it's in the SQL Server Slack channel or on Twitter, and chat about PowerShell. Check out tsqltuesday.com if you want to read all of the posts that people put up for TSQL Tuesday on PowerShell, or maybe you want to join us and participate in TSQL Tuesday yourself in a future month. I hope to see you soon. I'm Kendra Little from SQLWorkbooks.com.